The final item of business is a member's business debate on motion 3233 in the name of Colette Stevenson on access to cannabis-based products for medicinal use. The debate will be concluded without any questions being put, and I would ask those members who wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons now. I call on Colette Stevenson to open the debate. Up to 7 minutes, please, Ms Stevenson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I am grateful to members who supported my motion, and I will try to cover as much as I can in 7 minutes. First, though, I want to thank Rona Mackay and Polly McNeill, the co-conveners of the Parliament's cross-party group on medicinal cannabis. This area is complex and wide-ranging, so the work they and the CPG are doing is a very welcome contribution. When the Home Office rescheduled certain cannabis-based products for medicinal use, or CBPMs, in 2018, many people were relieved. Under the current setup, doctors can prescribe a medicinal product that has a valid marketing authorisation. But for unlicensed products, there is a restriction in place where only a subset of doctors, generally consultants, can prescribe. The only other access routes for patients are as participants in a clinical trial or through private prescriptions. Medicinal cannabis has been proposed as a treatment for a range of conditions, including multiple sclerosis, and I'd like to move on, thank you very much, and epilepsy. In the latter case, one product, Epidiolex, is now available on the NHS for some patients. The MS Society provided a useful briefing for today's debate where they mentioned another product, Sativex, which might get rolled out on the NHS, and that would be good to see. The Society also carried out a survey and found 22% of people with MS in the UK had accessed illegal forms of cannabis to treat their symptoms. There is a common theme there, and it's public knowledge that parents of young children with epilepsy from right across the UK had to resort to illegal access of products too, and really that's what forced the legislative change. As I said in my motion, a constituent who currently receives a medicinal cannabis product, Cole Thompson, aged 9, has a drug-resistant focal epilepsy. He used to have daily seizures and has spent a lot of time in hospital over the years. Since he started taking Bedrolight 3 years ago, however, he has been doing well. His mum, Lisa Quarrell, is in the gallery today. And I want to acknowledge the work she's done in campaigning for access to medicinal cannabis and her efforts to fundraise for Cole's medicine. Lisa shared a video on Facebook the other day with Cole doing Taekwondo and playing the drums. I can only imagine how proud of Cole and how relieved she is given the prognosis just a couple of years ago. You could argue that Cole and the few other children in a similar situation are a success story, but that would probably downplay the trials and tribulations facing parents like Lisa. For a start, Cole's Bedrolight is sourced through a private prescription costing over £1,200 per month. Lisa has found it impossible so far to meet an NHS consultant who would prescribe Bedrolight. I understand that many doctors are hesitant to prescribe cannabis-based products that do not have a marketing authorisation because these products often do not have a rigorous evidence base behind them, as licensed products are required to have. Furthermore, medical societies develop specific guidance for their members, some of which have raised concerns around the lack of clinical trials to demonstrate safety, quality and effectiveness. Patients, policymakers and clinicians are entitled to expect manufacturers to provide evidence. So I appreciate that point, but I would also challenge scientists, medics, pharmaceutical companies and any other relevant parties to consider the different ways evidence can be gathered. For example, the last meeting of the CPG focused on the role of evidence in widening the use of medicinal cannabis, and we heard about the potential for observational trials of patients already on a product. I welcome the Scottish Government's commitment to collaborate with NHS England and the National Institute for Health Research to support research trials so that we can give NHS consultants the reassurances they need to consider prescribing more cannabis-based medicines. I understand NHS England is involved in discussions on two clinical trials for adults and children with epilepsy, and that Scottish patients will be eligible. That is very welcome. However, when it comes to something like treatment-resistant epilepsy and a patient like Cole who has been doing well on a cannabis-based product, we have to be aware that certain research methods would not be acceptable to all patients. The go-to randomised control trial option that could see participants end up on a placebo or a different medication. Clearly, some patients and their loved ones would be reluctant to take part on that basis. There are a few other things I would be interested to know around CBPM use, and perhaps the Minister could touch upon in closing, such as how the CMO has worked with doctors since the rescheduling to get feedback and develop protocols or guidelines, what role the CMO and the CSO can play in supporting, encouraging or facilitating relevant research, whether shared care guidelines are under development, and whether SIGN could develop general or condition-specific guidelines. Lastly, we should consider the role of GPs too. I understand some GPs have indicated they would prescribe unlicensed cannabis-based medicinal products if they could, particularly where treatment has been initiated by a relevant consultant or they have seen firsthand the benefits to an individual patient. I would call on the Home Office and relevant stakeholders to consider options like this, in consultation with patient groups, GPs and others. To conclude, Presiding Officer, I am delighted to have kicked off this debate, the first in Scotland, on access to medicinal cannabis products. It's such a wide-ranging topic, and of course I wanted to spend some time talking about Cole Thompson from East Kilbride. More evidence is key to widening the use of these products, and I want to see movement on that as soon as possible. I hope I've given a flavour or just some of the opportunities and challenges in this area, and I'm looking forward to hearing other members' contributions. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Stevenson. I now call Rona Mackay to be followed by Craig Hoy. Up to 4 minutes, please, Ms Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As I've heard, this debate on access to medical cannabis is a first for this Parliament, a very important first, and I'd like to thank my colleague Colette Stevenson for bringing it to the Chamber. As a co-convener of the cross-party group on medical cannabis, this issue is long overdue to be debated. We've heard Colette Stevenson's heart-rending account of her constituent Lisa Quarrell and her son Cole. As a mother, I can't imagine the stress and heartache of having to fight every day to keep your child alive, and have the constant worry of how to pay for private prescriptions of the drug he depends on. Presiding Officer, around 40 other mothers in Scotland have children who have severe epilepsy, and like Lisa, they have to do this every day, not to mention the thousands of chronic pain sufferers and those with conditions for which cannabis can relieve the worst symptoms. Cannabis is the oldest medicine in recorded history. There's evidence of medicinal and religious use for over 4,000 years, so this is not a new drug. But, Presiding Officer, there's clearly stigma around the use of cannabis. The psychoactive aspect of cannabis is what I think scares people, but medicinal cannabis has very low levels of THC, that's the psychoactive component, which far outweigh the risk elements of side effects. Let's be clear, cannabis for medicinal use is not about people looking to chill out and have a good time. It's about giving people quality of life and pain relief when other drugs have failed to do that. Why should sufferers be denied that because of ill-informed prejudice? The misuse of drugs regulations in 2018 allowed for cannabis-based medicines to be legally prescribed for any condition. Thomas Mulvey of the Multiple Sclerosis Society has been calling on the Scottish Medicines Consortium to approve Savitex for some time. Cannabis-based Savatex has been shown to be hugely beneficial to treat symptoms associated with MS and will be considered by the SMC later this year. As my colleague Colette Stevenson said, the Society's UK-wide report into Savatex found that 22% of people living with MS had accessed illegal forms of cannabis. Yes, of course.
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And on the subject of Savatex, Savatex, as has been pointed out by Ms Mackay and Ms Stevenson, has a licence for the treatment of moderate to severe cases in terms of multiple sclerosis. The manufacturer, though, has not yet made a submission to the SMC, and as a result, it is not recommended for routine use on the NHS in Scotland. The SMC remains in discussions with the manufacturer of Savatex around their plans for submission, but the decision and timing of their submission is up to them. Now, I think members may want to encourage the company, but there's nothing we can do until they make that submission. And I wanted to let the Chamber know that that was the case on this very important issue.
Rona Mackay.
Thank the Minister for that clarification. And yes, that's actually really, really interesting, because the report found that 22% of people living with MS had accessed illegal forms of cannabis to treat their symptoms, and that's outrageous. So I understand that Sativex gained MHRA approval 10 years ago, and MS sufferers have been forced to break the law to gain access to it, so I hope that does change quickly. So why are we not prescribing such a demonstrably effective drug? There are currently no NHS patients in Scotland receiving CBM, and only 3 in the UK. International data tells a different story, but I don't have time to outline that. The barriers to prescribing appear to be NICE guidance, which, as I understand it, is not legally enforceable in Scotland and not legally challengeable by Scottish patients. This is typical of the legal confusion that surrounds the prescribing of cannabis-based drugs. However, NICE clarified that healthcare professionals in England should not feel prevented from considering the use of unlicensed products if appropriate for individual patients. While the regulation of medicines and medicinal products is a reserve power, funding for cannabis-based products through NHS prescriptions is a devolved issue. Only specialist doctors on the General Medical Council Special Register can prescribe unlicensed cannabis-based products for medicinal use. GPs cannot or will not prescribe them. Prescribing around the world is mostly through primary care, and for some reason the UK has gone down the route of allowing only specialists to prescribe. Weak clinical evidence is cited as a barrier, but I would argue that the thousands of patients whose lives have been improved immeasurably are evidence that they should be prescribed. Then there's the fear factor with clinicians, lack of awareness, lack of training. The General Medical Council, who are responsible for overseeing medical practitioners and good prescribing practice, is working with private clinicians in the prescribing of CBM. But it would appear that many NHS clinicians fear being struck off if they are to prescribe. Presiding Officer, I believe it's possible for Scotland to lead the way in cannabis research. My time in the cross-party group has been a huge learning curve for me. The issues around prescription are embedded in a legal minefield, but I'm optimistic that this will change soon. The Cabinet Secretary is liaising with the UK Government to discuss the need to build the evidence base for CBPMs, and he believes the UK and Scottish Government could work together to achieve this. So in conclusion, I urge this issue to be taken forward and clarified in Scotland without further delay. Look at international evidence, get the trials underway and sort out the legal complexities. The lives of thousands of patients, old and young, depend on it. Thank you.
Thank you. I call on Craig Hoy to be followed by Pauline McNeill. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr Hoy.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And may I take this opportunity to thank Colette Stevenson for bringing forward this timely members' debate in exploring access to cannabis-based products for medicinal use. As we heard, this is a complex situation and one where we are looking at a lot of emerging evidence. But what I do hope is that having this first debate in this chamber will focus the mind of members so that we can track this debate more closely. As Colette Stevenson said, this takes us into some new territory involving access, trials and new approaches to treating some complex medical needs such as MS. And I recognise, and I think my party recognises, the important role that medicinal cannabis plays and that it can be a critical lifeline for patients. Take, for example, the case of Alfie Dingley, a 10-year-old boy from Warwickshire who suffered up to 150 seizures a week. His mother launched a high-profile campaign which was recognised by the UK government and helped medical cannabis become legalised in the UK in 2018. Following this, Alfie has been able to grow up without a seizure for over 2 years since receiving support through the NHS. Unfortunately, however, Alfie's family are currently forced to seek private treatment to access the drug, which costs up to £2,000 a month. And this is clearly a serious financial burden, which many patients and parents seeking to use medicinal cannabis simply cannot afford. And this will undoubtedly be a source of great frustration that these drugs are not easily accessible for parents whose children are clearly suffering or are in pain. And I do not think that any parent should be forced to go down the route of illegally accessing drugs in order to alleviate their suffering and the suffering of their children when there is a responsible and legal alternative. UK government ministers are well aware of these issues, and I am encouraged that ministers are working to reduce the import and export costs for medicinal cannabis. And it is important that we explore every option to ensure greater access to the drug for medicinal use. The National Institute for Health and Social Care Excellence believes that more evidence is needed to justify the prescription of unlicensed cannabis products. But to this end, we must ensure that patients are treated effectively with medicinal cannabis and that they are not adversely affected by any negative sides of the drug. And again, this is where I think it's important that we look to trials. I think it's also important that each case is judged individually by a clinician, and I believe that the decision should remain solely with them. But I do think there is a case for looking at greater understanding of the role of different clinicians, including GPs, in relation to this. I warmly welcome the work of the UK government in this area, which has seen 13 ongoing trials in the UK and 6 other trials already completed. And I look forward to further clinical trials and the greater use of an evidence-based approach and observation-based trials, which I think will be critical in the future development. Additionally, presently, there are 2 new clinical trials into treating refractory epilepsy that are being developed by the National Institute for Health Research and NHS England. And I think, again, we would warmly welcome those and look forward to the result of those. I think it is important that we have an evidence-based approach. I think it's important that we take this issue and discuss it in this Parliament and in elsewhere. And I look forward to following that debate, both in this Parliament and in the wider UK context. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call Polly McNeill to be followed by Emma Harper. Up to 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Firstly, sincere thanks to Colette Stevenson for hosting the first ever debate on medicinal cannabis, and she should be proud of that. But also thanks to Rona Mackay, my co-convener for the first ever group on cross-party group on medicinal cannabis, and also to Anna Ross, who is in the gallery, who is the secretary to the group, and Kate Spence and Rona staff who have supported the setting up of this group. And it really is, I think, making a huge difference to cannabis patients having a forum to bring the big issues. The question, I think, now is whether we're making enough progress, and I want to talk about that. Cannabis is the oldest recorded medicine in history. It is not a new medicine. Lots of people get relief from it, but yet there are so many barriers to what should be a basic and fundamental right to access treatment that gives you relief from pain and able to do more things in your life you previously couldn't do. So some people get incredible relief from that. Even though the UK legalised access to cannabis in late 2018, it is only prescribed as a last-line treatment when all other treatment options have failed. And we need to work to change this. We've heard already for some people, especially the children like Cole Thompson, it has changed their lives, and it's frustrating to see parents such as Lisa Thompson in financial peril trying month after month to access Bedrolight for Cole's epilepsy. When if you were a Dutch patient, you would access it at a not-for-profit cost at a Dutch pharmacy. And the seizures that accompany these type of drug-resistant epilepsy can be life-threatening. There are many young children in this situation. I think it's important to note that. Also, Rona Mackay and myself are due to meet Police Scotland to get clarity on a number of cases where patients have legally prescribed cannabis prescriptions still facing court action because of a lack of understanding on the front line. And I'm sure we can get that resolved, but this is really, really important that that is. Similar to Lisa and Cole, Tanine Montgomery's six-year-old daughter, Indy Rose, has a similar drug-resistant epilepsy, and she says that the family flew to the Netherlands to obtain it from a Dutch doctor using a private UK prescription because the NHS refused to pay for it. And Tanine said that she has spent £34,000 and broken the law to keep her daughter alive. So we simply can't expect families to continue to take these kind of risks to keep their children alive. It's frankly immoral. There is evidence, as others have said, that medicinal cannabis helps to relieve MS-related spasticity. Muscle spasms or stiffness, known as spasticity, affects up to 80% of people with MS. And Sativex is the main product available in England and Wales for this. And Rona Mackay said this earlier, the NICE guidelines recommend offering a four-week trial of Sativex to treat adults with MS. But in Scotland, the issue has been that the manufacturer did not make a submission to the Medicines Consortium. The Sativex is not routinely available. However, it is due to be considered later this year. And the MS Society produced a report into this and found that 22% of those living with MS had accessed illegal forms of cannabis to treat their symptoms. This just seems to be very wrong to me. In fact, one of the reasons I've spoken in this Parliament why I set up the cross-party group is my own father, who had acute pain from arthritis, said if it ever became legalised, then he would use it. And it's a testimony to him that I've championed this cause. But like many other cannabis-based medicines, while it can be accessed by private prescription, doctors are often hesitant to prescribe it without SMC approval. So there is a big issue about confidence in doctors and some confusion about who can prescribe and who can't. Medicines can be legally prescribed by specialist doctors on the GMC specialist register if there is a special clinical need, but GPs cannot prescribe unlicensed cannabis-based products for medicinal use under the current rules. So I believe there needs to be some changes to that. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, it's time for serious change to the policy and the delivery of access to medicinal cannabis. We need to make sure that trials are the appropriate trials for this kind of use. We raised this 3 years ago with the Chief Pharmaceutical Officer, and we've made very little progress. I believe we should empower doctors and we should empower patients who need this because it is changing their lives, and I look forward to the Minister's reply. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I now call Emma Harper to be followed by Alex Cole-Hamilton. Up to 4 minutes, please, Ms Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome the opportunity to speak in this debate and congratulate my friend and colleague, Colette Stevenson, on securing this debate. And I want to thank my office manager, Scott McElvinney, for his assistance and research to help me prepare for this. And it is really interesting to hear directly what the impact that this has had on Cole's life and Lisa's experience. And it is really important that this debate is here in chamber today. And for me, just as synthetic drugs can help some conditions and not others, it is important to note that cannabis isn't a one-size-fits-all line of treatment. It is also important that we make the distinction between legalising cannabis for recreational purposes and for medical treatment. When discussing legalised forms of medicinal cannabis, it is chemical elements from within the plant that we are seeing the benefits from. And I absolutely recognise and agree with Rona Mackay about the stigma associated around this, because it is really important that we're highlighting the medicinal effects and not the THC effects that other people might be seeking. The benefits are becoming more evident through proper clinical trials and research and global research, as well as at Glasgow University. The research suggests that the benefits of cannabis come from some of its compounds, cannabinoids like cannabidiol CBD. Interestingly, Hilltop Leaf Limited, which is a private medicinal cannabis cultivation and extraction business, which aims to provide an alternative plant-based clinical treatment to synthetic pharmaceuticals, has opened a site in Dumfries and Galloway with South Scott Enterprise funding, and they're growing cannabis for medicinal research and use. These compounds can translate to multiple physical benefits. And when I worked as a post-anaesthesia care nurse, pain management and pain relief was critical as part of my job, whether I was given IV morphine, IV diamorph or intravenous paracetamol. And that was acute pain management. But a lot of these drugs are also used in chronic pain management too. So I was really interested that the evidence from the various clinical trials that have generally agreed that medical cannabis does reduce pain by altering pain pathways in the brain. The evidence from these studies shows the benefits of cannabis-based drugs for patients with arthritis, fibromyalgia, endometriosis and migraine. And in some instances, these drugs are reported to help replace the long-term use of non-steroid anti-inflammatory drugs, NSAIDs, like ibuprofen, which also have negative side effects. So CBD can help reduce inflammation as well, and clinical trials have been carried out for patients living with Crohn's disease, it's irritable bowel syndrome and rheumatoid arthritis. In every one of these studies, cannabis-based medication decreased inflammation and led to increased independence and greater well-being for patients. And well-being is something we should absolutely support and pursue. Due to the effects on the limbic system, research is being carried out, including here in Scotland, by Glasgow University, on the ability of cannabis-based medication to treat anxiety, epilepsy, multiple sclerosis, Parkinson's, post-traumatic stress disorder, Tourette's syndrome even, and insomnia. There is clearly a body of international evidence into the benefits of medicinal forms of cannabis, and we should be further exploring regulated forms of medicinal cannabis for prescription here in Scotland. Following the changes to the misuse of drugs legislation in 2018, cannabis-based products can be prescribed in cases of special need. So we have heard already there are three products that I'm aware of, Epididylex, Sativex and Nabilone. Epididylex is recommended for prescription here in Scotland, but we have seen difficulties from our general practitioners about the way that the drugs can be prescribed or not be prescribed. And some of the Royal College of GPs have said that they've been pressurised to prescribe unlicensed medical cannabis products, the reason being because patients with life-limiting conditions read social media posts about the benefits of medicinal cannabis products. So the RCGP have shared their concerns over the lack of medical cannabis products available. And I would encourage what we can do to ask the Minister for supporting the GPs in their practice to take any clinical guidance forward and see what education is available for patients and clinicians about the product. So in closing, I'm conscious of time. I agree that there are many benefits for medicinal cannabis compounds and products and encourage the Scottish Government to continue to support clinical research into these products to improve the outcomes for people and health conditions for these folk that are totally life-limiting. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call Alex Cole-Hamilton to be followed by Tess White. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr. Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you very much indeed, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm very pleased to rise from my party to speak in this important debate, and I'd like to congratulate Colette Stevenson for bringing this to Parliament and for an excellent speech, I think, summarising some of the barriers that a number of MSPs have faced trying to help constituents. I will come on to that. Many of us, Deputy Presiding Officer, in this chamber write a weekly newspaper column, and I vividly remember writing one to celebrate the Home Office decision to issue the first long-term licence for personal use of medical cannabis. That was 4 years ago, and yet today most patients, as we have heard, who could benefit from cannabis therapies just are not getting access to them through the NHS. My own constituent, Murray Gray, who I have mentioned many times in this chamber, is now 9 years old and has a profound and complex form of epilepsy that regular medications just cannot touch. In early 2019, Murray's epilepsy took a dramatic turn. He entered what's known as status, that is a condition where the seizures just won't end. It's like a rolling thunderstorm in Murray's brain, and he wouldn't come round. Murray was having literally hundreds of life-threatening seizures every single day, and it's highly likely that he would have died had his mum, Karen Gray, not moved heaven and earth to obtain private prescription for Bedrolite, a cannabis oil that she gets from the Netherlands. Karen administered the medicine to Murray herself, and in a short space of time, Murray's seizures dropped away altogether. Karen knows that were she to stop giving him his daily dose of cannabis oils, then Murray would return to a state of near constant seizure. She has had to find £1,300 every single month for the cost of a prescription, and at times it has brought her family to the edge of financial ruin. The problem is that even though Murray's GP is willing to prescribe the oils, he is not on the approved list that we had described of those who clinicians who can. And none of those who are on it are willing to. It's the point I would have actually made to Colette Stevenson when she was making her speech. I think this is a problem we encounter time and time again. There's a catch-22 of the people who know their patients unable to prescribe, yet the people, the consultants on that very short list, unable to. It's not because they think it's bad for him. They're just not entirely sure that the drug of the drug because of the lack of UK trial data. They also probably still have a residual anxiety around cannabis therapies and how that jars up against the Misuse of Drugs Act. And it's not just Murray who's struggling to get help, the help that he needs. Only 3 NHS prescriptions have been issued in the whole of the UK for some of these therapies. And Murray's older brother, Dean, hand-delivered a letter into Bute House asking the First Minister to help his mum cover the cost. The reply came back, there was not enough evidence that Murray's treatment is safe and that the government were powerless to act. Presiding officer, this treatment is literally keeping Murray alive. It's hard to see how stopping it would be safer than taking it. And 3 children in the UK already have an NHS prescription. It's safe in those circumstances. It's surely safe for Murray. The government can't compel clinicians to write scripts. I understand that. But it can support Karen and others who find themselves in a similar position. The government must also do all it can to make sure that clinical trials on medical cannabis are conducted to give clinicians the confidence they need. Presiding officer, there are also cases of police being behind the curve on that. Recently, a man in Shetland who uses medical cannabis for chronic migraines had it confiscated when the police claimed he hadn't provided satisfactory evidence it was being legally prescribed. It wasn't until my colleague Beatrice Wisher intervened that it was returned to him, but he had already been issued with a police caution, which he'd have to go through the process of appealing. Presiding officer, there is clearly the need for liberalisation across the board when it comes to medical cannabis. Outdated views and unnecessary taboos are too often getting in the way of the immense benefits that these treatments can provide. For the sake of Murray and others like him, we all need to catch up with the science. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call on Tess White to be followed by Monica Lennon. Up to 4 minutes, please, Ms. White.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm grateful to Colette Stevenson for securing the time for this debate. At the outset, it's important to acknowledge that those people seeking to access cannabis-based medicine are often in significant pain and have a diminished quality of life. It's very difficult to ignore the desperation they feel, especially when the health and well-being of children is involved. Colette Stevenson mentioned Cole Thompson, who at not even 10 years old suffered up to 20 epileptic seizures a day before being privately prescribed cannabis oil. This must have been unimaginably distressing for him and his mum, Lisa, who's been a tireless advocate for her son. In particular, patients feel a deep frustration that while the scheduling of cannabis-based products changed in 2018, clinical use remains low, and only for specific conditions in exceptional circumstances. Many have sought private treatment, which has significant cost implications, sometimes, as we've heard today, amounting to hundreds and even thousands of pounds a month. That's simply not a sustainable financial outlay. Others have accessed illegal forms of cannabis to treat symptoms. Research by the MS Society has shown that almost a quarter of MS sufferers have obtained cannabis-based products that are illegal to possess. Often the strength of THC and the quality of the ingredients in these products are not known, with the potential to cause harm to the user. It's also important to note that there's a different prescribing regime in England and Scotland for medicinal cannabis. That geographic disparity is felt acutely by sufferers of MS north of the border, where Sativex has not been approved by the Scottish Medicines Consortium. I understand from Spice, and also confirmed today by the Minister, that this is because the holder of the NHS marketing authorisation has not made a submission for this product. I do hope that there will be some action following this debate today. I would also add that while the therapeutic benefits of cannabis-based products for certain conditions have been conclusively demonstrated, There is a risk that such products could be seen as a panacea by people in acute pain and discomfort. As these individuals seek to effectively manage their conditions, clinicians and healthcare professionals are trying to manage patient expectations. Doctors are also professionally responsible for any medicine as they are weighing up an individual's suffering as well as their safety. We don't want, however, people to turn to the illicit market and the harms that could involve. Deputy Presiding Officer, it's for clinicians to determine the risks and the benefits of medicinal cannabis, not politicians. I do, however, agree with Colette Stevenson's call for further research in this area with high quality and robust clinical trials to contribute to the evidence base. I understand that there are more than a dozen ongoing trials in the UK, which is welcome. I will conclude by echoing calls for collaboration and cooperation between the Scottish and UK governments on this issue. The UK has a thriving life sciences sector that is at the forefront of scientific research, and we must capitalise on this expertise across the four nations. Thank you.
Thank you. And I now call on Monica Lennon, who will be the last speaker before I ask the Minister to respond to the debate. Up to 4 minutes, please, Ms Lennon.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and congratulations to Colette Stevenson on securing this debate, but also bringing together members from across the Chamber who clearly are very passionate and very concerned and want to make progress. So it's always good when we have members' debates to find out what members really care about. It's also really good that we have the cross-party group now. That's a real forum for change to happen, and hopefully one of the ministers will be able to come along in due course as a member of that group. I'm pleased to be working with people across the Parliament and outside. So it's good to see Anna Ross in the gallery, along with Lisa Quirrell. And also I can see Councillor Monique McAdam, who's also been a real ally and support to Lisa. But it can't be left to individual parents and individual families to fight this battle. It's a battle for all of us. So I think there's a lot that's been said already about the barriers and about the challenges. But I think the job that we have now in this Parliament is to focus on what we can do in Holyrood, in the Scottish Parliament, rather than the things that we can't do. I was speaking to Lisa Quirrell about Cole's situation, and I know that Lisa is very anxious that we make progress, not just for Cole, but for anybody who needs this medication. Lisa pointed out to me that the sign guidance that we have in Scotland is quite old now. I think it's 2013, so that's perhaps due an update, and it'd be good to hear from the Minister in his response what the situation is there. I will focus my time on Cole Thompson. I've mentioned Cole in the Chamber before, so he's not a stranger to this Chamber, or indeed the First Minister and Jean Freeman when she was Cabinet Secretary. When a parent also has to become a carer for their child, it's absolutely exhausting. But when they also have to battle against systems and institutions and fight for everything, it's really heartbreaking to watch. So I think it's good in East Kilbride and Central Scotland that we have a number of MSPs willing to support Lisa, but it does need change to come at government level. Cole is an exceptional wee boy. I've had the privilege of meeting Cole, and what's really encouraging about his journey and the fact he's now on this medication is keeping him alive and seizure free. Is it's also given him back his education, it's given him back his hopes and his dreams. I was asking Lisa, you know, what would Cole say if he was here today? And his mum said, Cole, who is nine, who's in P5, said, I just don't want to go back to being sick again and to go back to being in a wheelchair. I want to be a black belt. How wonderful is that? So it's our duty in this place not just to offer sympathy and warm words, but show Cole and other children like Murray what we're actually going to do to help them realise their hopes and their dreams. I think Cole will achieve that black belt and a whole lot more, but he will need our help to get there. I think something that's really important to mention as well, the people who are willing to speak up and put their heads above the parapet. So here is Mrs Graham, who's principal teacher in Cole's school. And she talks about the difference that the medication has made to Cole's life. and she's really, really proud of Cole because of that. But she's written to the NHS and to the Cabinet Secretary, Humza Yousaf, to basically say that it's her duty, she has a duty of care towards Cole in terms of meeting his educational needs. But she also says, surely you also have a duty of care, not you, presiding officer, but the NHS and the Cabinet Secretary. Surely you also have a duty of care, a duty to ensure that Cole gets the correct medication and treatment to give him the best quality of life. And I think that also looking at comments from Tracy, and I forgot Tracy's surname, Tracy from Unison, who works closely with Lisa. She reminds us all that in the NHS we have the right to get treatment free at the point of need. So surely Cole has that right. Surely Cole has the right to grow up in Scotland with the right support and the right resources. So I know that is the time up, presiding officer, but I think it's been a really good debate, not just to highlight individuals who need the support now, but we have to get this right for the people who don't have a voice, the people whose mums are maybe not quite as vocal as Cole's mum. And I'm really keen to hear what the minister has to say, because I think in this chamber we're all on the same page, we all want to go in the same direction, and we want to give little boys like Cole Thompson the hope and the route map to get to that black belt. Thank you.
Thank you. And I now call on Kevin Stewart, Minister, to respond to the debate. Up to 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I want to thank Colette Stevenson for tabling this important, comprehensive, and I think very fairly balanced motion, and on securing this first ever debate on this issue. So plaudits to Ms Stevenson for that. And members today have related the experiences of families who find themselves in such painful and distressing circumstances trying to do their best for their children. And we've also heard from many members how it has been how families have accessed cannabis-based products using their own money through private prescriptions, and the further pressure that this has placed on already stretched family finances. And I'd really like to thank all of the members for the tone of today's debate, because I think that is very important as we move forward on this issue. I'm quite sure, Presiding Officer, that all of us can only have enormous sympathy for any family or any patient who finds themselves in this extremely difficult position. And I'm quite sure that we will all understand their desire to explore any avenue to help them or their loved one. In my contribution today, therefore, I want to reflect briefly on what the Scottish Government has the powers over in this area, the situation now, and what we are seeking to do to try to help. Presiding Officer, the regulation of medicines is at the moment a UK government responsibility undertaken by the Medicines and Healthcare Products Regulatory Agency. Before a medicine is marketed, the manufacturer must demonstrate its safety, quality and efficacy. Applications for a marketing authorisation, also known as a licence, must include data demonstrating its quality, safety and efficacy. And the MHRA will consider this data before a licence is granted. And I should also note that when the law changed in 2018, it did not relate directly to providing these products within the National Health Service. And the rescheduling of products under the Misuse of Drugs Act did not alter the role of clinicians in deciding what treatments to prescribe to patients. Clinicians make these decisions on a case-by-case basis, taking account of the specific needs of the individual. And government ministers cannot, and I'm quite sure everybody agrees, should not intervene in these clinical decisions. And there have been... I'll give way very briefly.
Alex Cole-Hamilton.
I'm very grateful to the Minister for giving way, and I understand the limitations in front of his government in terms of helping these families. But the one power this Parliament does have, or his government does have, is to create bespoke benefits. And he could work with other ministerial colleagues to create a benefit to reimburse the very small number of families who are right now having to privately fund these prescriptions. Would he agree to look at that?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, again, this is a very difficult area, because the government is, of course, very well aware that families have spent substantial sums on private prescriptions for cannabis-based products. And I hope that the Parliament will understand that the cost of the treatment sought privately must be met privately and not consume funding that would otherwise be made available to the NHS. But what I would say is that what we should be striving to do here is getting this move forward, underlying the importance of new products being developed and fully assessed so that they can then be licensed and considered for general availability on the NHS here in Scotland. I think that's what we would all want to strive for, and that is what we should do, Presiding Officer. I'll give way very briefly to Ms McNeill.
I'm very grateful to the Minister for giving way. I wondered if you can respond now or later in terms of, does the government have any policy about how we can move this on? For example, there are barriers in clinical trials. Myself and Alex Cole-Hammond have said we'd raised this many years ago. And we don't seem to be making any progress on that. And doctors need confidence. I mean, I understand it's government policy to be in favour of it, but can you be specific at any point as to what, how you're going to unblock some of the ways in which people are being prevented from getting it on the NHS?
Minister. Presiding Officer, I'm going to try and explain in this speech how we plan to move forward in all of this. I don't have very much time left, so I hope you may be a little bit lenient with time. And what I don't cover in today's speech, I will write to individual members around about the issues that they have raised. Presiding Officer, since the changes in UK regulations, doctors on the specialist register of the General Medical Council have been able to prescribe an unlicensed cannabis-based product for medicinal use if clinically appropriate for their patients. And a lot of people have covered GPs today, and GPs may prescribe licensed cannabis-based medicines subject to any restrictions under the product's licence. But the law also allows GPs to prescribe unlicensed products under the direction of a specialist as part of a shared care arrangement. In Scotland, as has been highlighted earlier, the only licensed cannabis-based product for medicinal use at the moment is Epidiolox, which is licensed for severe epilepsy. That drug has been through randomised controlled trials and has been assessed by the MHRA and the Scottish Medicines Consortium. This means that, unlike other cannabis-derived products, it has been assessed for quality, safety and efficacy and clinical use and effectiveness.
I'll give a bit of time back to the Minister.
Thank
Tess White.
Thank you, Minister. Will the Minister recognise that there is a different prescribing regime in England and Scotland, and there is a disparity, and can we do some work to bridge that? Thank you.
Minister.
Presiding Officer, I don't think that is quite right, and I will get back to Ms White with some of the specifics. There is a huge amount in front of me here around about how GPs, what GPs can and cannot do. I'm not going to have time to do all of that today, read through all of that today with the Chamber. But what I will do is I will write to all members who have taken part in today's debate outlining how all of that works, if that's suitable for members. Presiding Officer, our clinicians are professionally and clinically responsible for any medicine that they prescribe, and the responsibility when prescribing an unlicensed product is greater than when prescribing a licensed medicine. And that is why, before prescribing an unlicensed product, a clinician must be satisfied that there is sufficient evidence or experience on its safety and efficacy. And where they feel it is not appropriate to prescribe a particular product, then they do not have to. And where the evidence base remains limited and there is not full clarity of the risks or harms, it is right that doctors are cautious to prescribe such products. If I can move on a little bit to some recent clinical guidelines which demonstrate a clear need for more evidence on the safety, quality and effectiveness of unlicensed medicines to support that routine prescribing on the NHS. That, as members know, is why access on the NHS remains limited and prescribing is almost entirely within the private sector. And it's also why the Scottish Government continues to support the development of new clinical trials. Current evidence for the medicinal use of unlicensed cannabis-based products is from small, low-quality observational studies and patient-reported outcomes. I hope members will understand that it would not be safe to allow for general access on the basis of such limited data. And we have learnt in the UK in the past, unfortunately, about the dangers of allowing new medicines to be given to patients without their first being thorough testing of safety and efficacy. And that's why we are supporting the establishment of clinical trials led by NHS England and the National Institute for Health and Care Research. I think somebody asked, I think it might have been Emma Harper, around about the CSO involved, Chief Scientific Officer's involvement. He has been in discussions around about these issues too.
The Minister really needs to conclude, I'm sorry.
These randomised controlled trials will involve two groups of patients, adults and children with epilepsy, and for each there will be three arms. One arm with a cannabidiol known as CBD, one with a tetrahydrocannabinol, commonly referred to as a THC, which is the principal psychoactive constituent of cannabis, and one arm with a placebo. And I understand that the study team will announce the plans for the trials as soon as possible, Presiding Officer, including when patient recruitment is expected to commence and the trials complete. And it is essential, absolutely essential, and we've touched upon this earlier on the debate in my response to Rona Mackay, that it's manufacturers need to come with us to conduct the research, and despite repeated calls, some in the cannabis industry have largely failed to invest in clinical trials, although GW Pharmaceuticals stands as a noteworthy exception to all of this. Presiding Officer, as I conclude, I want to assure the Parliament that the Government has been clear and unambiguous on its support for exploring solutions in this very difficult situation. And we are more than willing to work on a cross-party basis to ensure that we move forward on that front. We are committed to working with clinicians, with the UK Government and with regulators. Crucially, we do need those manufacturers to take the steps needed in clinical trials so that patients and families can get the help and support that they need as quickly as possible. And if we can build an alliance across this chamber, it may well be that we can work well together to persuade those manufacturers to do exactly that. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes the debate. I would ask the Minister, when he is writing in the terms he referred to each member who participated in the debate this evening, that he also, I would also request that he also ensures that Spice receive a copy of that, just so that the information is widely in the public domain. And thank you, Minister. And with that, I close this meeting.